Good morning, students. Here we start with our beautiful topic of gross anatomy of the kidneys, one of the important topics of the abdomen. Now, as we have discussed in our gross anatomy lectures of spleen, pancreas, how to write any organs, we follow several points such as definition of the organ, then its situation and extent, that is upon its location, then we come down to its measurement, size and shape, then we come down to its external features. Then we come down to relations, then we come down to blood supply, then we come down to lymphatic drainage and nerve supply, and lastly applied endotomy. These are the several points which you have to follow during description in theory of any of the organs. Similarly, we will follow the gross anatomy of kidneys. We will divide this in various segments. It is a very interesting topic. How do we present this? We have the same, we follow the same points to present this. First will be definition. What the students need to present in the paper, in theory, will be following these points. That is, first the definition is, kidneys will be a pair of excretory organs. Very important sentence. They are a pair of excretory organs. Second sentence will be, they will also function as endocrine organs. Second will be, they will also function as endocrine organs. So they will function as pair of excretory organs as well as endocrine organs. Why? You have to mention one more sentence here. Why they are functioning as a pair of endocrine organs? Because they will release renin, which will regulate the blood pressure. They will also release erythropoietin, which will help in maturation of RBC, and they will also release 1,25-hydroxycholecalciferol. 1,25-hydroxycholecalciferol for the regulation of calcium metabolism. Because of these three hormones which are produced, renin, erythropoietin and 1,25-hydroxycholecalciferol, it will be known as an organ to serve as endocrine. So therefore it comes under that endocrine purpose. Functionally, kidney, because it secretes these three hormones, it is also known as an endocrine organ. Basically, it is a, kidneys are a pair of excretory organs. So this completes the introduction, definition of the kidney. Here we complete our introduction of the kidneys. Now we move to second step. In the second step, immediately you have to describe what will be the situation and extent, or rather it is known as situation and extent, or it will be known as location. So in this one point, they are retroperitoneal organs. Please mention this point. Kidneys are retroperitoneal organs. They are situated behind the peritoneum. So they are located retroperitoneally. Then regarding its extent, they are always located from T12 to L3. So this will be their extent. The kidneys will be located from vertebral level T12 to vertebral level L3. So here we finish our situation and extent and location. Then we come down to axis. Remember, in kidneys we have to mention two axes: longitudinal and transverse axis. Now, longitudinal axis of the kidneys will be directed downwards laterally. Downwards laterally. That means their upper ends of the kidneys will be more towards the vertebral column, towards the median plane, than their lower ends. Because longitudinal axis, the axis will be like this, downwards and laterally. Transverse axis, the transverse axis of the kidneys, both the kidneys will be directed laterally and backwards, laterally and backwards. These two points you have to mention. Transverse axis of both the kidneys directed laterally and backwards. Longitudinal axis directed downwards and laterally. After finishing the axis, you have to mention size and shape. What is the size and shape of the kidneys? So next point will be, here I will mention size and shape. Now in order to understand the size and shape, let us first draw both the kidneys. We come on this side to draw both the kidneys. Now here we shall draw, this is the right kidney And here I will mention, this is the right kidney. Over here, I will draw left kidney. So this will be our left kidney. Now as I have drawn, I hope both are visible, okay. So as I have drawn, the right kidney will be slightly lower than the left kidney. Right kidney will be slightly lower than the left kidney because of the presence of liver above it. There is one point. Many times these points are asked in Viva or one mark question answer. Left kidney will be slightly narrower than the right kidney. You can look at the diagram. The right kidney I have drawn slightly larger than the left kidney. Left kidney is narrower and longer than the right kidney. And left kidney will be placed more towards the vertebral column. We know that both the kidneys are on either side of vertebral column. So left kidney will be slightly placed more towards the vertebral column. And the right kidney will be lower than the left kidney. So now, what will be the shape? The shape of the kidneys, as we can see in the diagram, the kidneys will be bean-shaped with their hilum directed medially. The hilum of both the kidneys, they are directed medially. What will be the size? Shape is bean-shaped with their hilum directed medially. The size will be, this is very important, the size will be, here I will mark it, 11 centimeter in length by 6 centimeters in breadth by 3 centimeters in thickness. So 11 centimeter by 6 centimeter by 3 centimeters, length, breadth and thickness. Please note down. Many times this is asked in MCQ also or in one mark question answer. This is the exact size of the gross anatomy of the kidneys. So shape and size, we have completed this point. Now we move ahead. To complete this diagram now, this is the first diagram. Here we shall draw inferior vena cava and abdominal aorta. To draw the inferior vena cava, we draw the inferior vena cava slightly more on the right side. And then we show this as the right renal vein. This is the inferior vena cava. And here we shall draw this as the left renal vein. This is the left renal vein. Now, abdominal aorta. In the abdominal aorta, here we shall draw, this is the abdominal aorta, slightly on the left side, and then we are going to show the right and left renal arteries. So here, still we continue with the abdominal aorta. This is our abdominal aorta, and then we show, this is the right side renal artery, and over here we show the left side renal artery. So here we complete the diagram, and therefore here we can mention inferior vena cava, and over here abdominal aorta, and over here these two are the renal vessels, right side, left side renal vessels, renal veins, renal arteries, right and left. So we complete this gross anatomy diagram where we show the size, shape of both the kidneys, the hilum and the entry of the renal vessels. Now after size and shape, 11 centimeter by 6 centimeter by 3 centimeters and bean shape, we move to next point. The next point should be regarding transpyloric plane. This point has to be mentioned because this is also many times asked in Viva one mark question answer. The level of passage of transpyloric plane, we know that the transpyloric plane will pass across L1. It will always cross L1 vertebra, L1 vertebral level. So transpyloric plane will always pass through the upper part of the hilum of the right kidney and lower part of the hilum of the left kidney. That is the passage of transpyloric plane. Transpyloric plane will always pass through the upper part of hilum of right kidney and cross the lower part of hilum of the left kidney. Please note down, transpyloric plane. Upper part of hilum of right kidney, lower part of hilum of the left kidney. Next point. Palpability of the kidneys. Are the kidneys palpable? No. The kidneys are not palpable in an average adult healthy human being. So in an average adult healthy human being, the kidneys are not palpable. But if the human being is very thin, then maybe the kidneys are palpable by bimanual examination. By bimanual test, bimanual examination, the kidneys are palpable in very thin persons. Now comes the most important point. This is a viva question. What are the factors that will keep the kidneys in position? We know the vertebral levels, T12 to L3. Paravertebral, retroperitoneal, T12 to L3. What are the factors when we dissect, when we see in the posterior abdominal wall, from T12 level to L3 level, we see the kidneys. What are the factors that will help in keeping the kidneys in its position? The factors are, number one, these factors are very important, short question. The factors which will help in keeping the kidneys in proper position, the factors will be, number one, pressure of the surrounding viscera. The pressure of surrounding viscera. Similarly, the tone of abdominal muscles. The tone of abdominal muscles. Similarly, as you can see, the renal vessels, where are they entering or exiting the kidneys? They are either entering or exiting the kidneys at the hilum of the kidneys. So this is known as pedicle. So here, next point can be the pedicles of the kidney that are present at the hilum, that allow the entry or exit of the renal vessels. So even these pedicles at the hilum of the kidney, which has the presence of renal pelvis, the renal vessels as well as renal pelvis also, will help in proper fixation of the kidneys, will help in keeping the kidneys in its cross anatomical position. That is one of the factors, pedicles of the kidney. Then we come down to next point, the most important point, that will help in keeping the kidneys in its proper location. The disposition of renal fascia and surrounding perinephric and paranephric fat, which I am going to explain it to you. The surrounding fat layers around the renal fascia. So disposition of renal fascia and the fatty tissue, which is surrounding the kidneys in the form of perinephric and paranephric layers, or perinephric and paranephric fascia, they will help in keeping the kidneys in its proper position. So these are the factors that will help the kidneys in keeping them at their proper position. That is T12 to L3, retroperitoneal on either side of vertebral column. After finishing this, we come to the next point, which is very important point in gross anatomy of the kidneys, coverings of kidney. So when we are going to dissect the posterior abdominal wall, when we see the location, first we see the coverings of kidney. What are the coverings of kidney? The coverings of the kidney will be, when we want to understand the coverings of the kidney, four different covers will be there. There will be presence of four covers of the kidney. Please come on this side. And what are those covers? From within to outside, or from inside to outside, or from deep to superficial, the following are the coverings of the kidneys. For example, here I will just write down fibrous capsule, that is cover number one. Coverings of the kidneys from inside to outside, first is fibrous capsule. This is the true capsule, fibrous capsule. Then number two, there will be a layer of perinephric fat surrounding the fibrous capsule, perinephric fat. Surrounding the fibrous capsule, perinephric fat. Layer number three, the most important. Many times this individual layer is asked as a short note. Many times. Write in short for 3 marks, maybe 2 marks or 4 marks. And that is renal fascia. Other name of renal fascia is fascia of Gerota. Please note down. So either it is called renal fascia or fascia of Gerota. G-E-R-O-T-A. This is a false capsule. Remember, fascia of Gerota or renal fascia is a false capsule. Finally, the last layer, outermost layer, paranephric fat. It is called paranephric fat. So once again, from inside to outside, what are the layers of the kidney? They are the fibrous capsule, which is the true capsule. External to it is perinephric fat. External to it is fascia of Gerota or renal fascia. External to it is paranephric fat. 4 layers. Now, we consider fibrous capsule. Of course, we are going to draw the diagram, but first we consider the fibrous capsule. What is basically fibrous capsule? Several important points you need to know about fibrous capsule, and those points will be, I will just take the duster over here. The most important points will be in the fibrous capsule. Definition of fibrous capsule. How fibrous capsule is formed? It is formed by the peripheral condensation of fibrous stroma, or it is formed by condensation of fibrous stroma of the kidney itself. So the condensation of, it is formed by condensation of fibrous stroma of the kidney itself. We know what is fibrous stroma. It is a fibrous connective tissue. Stroma means the connective tissue. So condensation of the fibrous stroma of the kidney will form a capsule covering the entire organ, and the fibrous capsule will cover the entire kidney. It will cover the entire kidney. This fibrous capsule, as it covers the entire kidney, because it is a condensation of the fibrous stroma of the kidney itself, and this fibrous capsule has two important applied anatomy features. Two important features are there. These two important points you need to understand about fibrous capsule, you need to remember. What are those? We know that the fibrous capsule is a condensation of the fibrous stroma of kidney. It will cover the entire kidney. And this fibrous capsule, sometimes in cases of certain operations such as nephropexy. Now, what is nephropexy? Nephropexy. Nephropexy is an operation where if there is excess of movements of the kidney. One point which I need to tell you is kidney like spleen is subdiaphragmatic organ below the diaphragm. That is why the kidneys will move along with respiration. Just like spleen, the kidneys will move along with respiration because they are subdiaphragmatic organs. Now, in certain cases where there is excess of movements of kidney, in those cases, there should be surgical fixation of the kidneys. And those kind of operations are called nephropexy. Nephropexy. So what will the surgeon do in nephropexy? In nephropexy type of operations where the kidneys need to be fixed, the lateral border of the kidney, the fibrous capsule is cut across the lateral border of the kidneys, across these lateral border of the kidneys. This is the lateral border of the kidney. This is the medial border of left kidney. This is the lateral border of the left kidney. So lateral border of the kidney, the fibrous capsule will be incised. Then what will happen will be the posterior layer of the fibrous capsule. The posterior layer of fibrous capsule will be then attached above to the 12th rib or posterior abdominal muscles. So the posterior layer of fibrous capsule will be then sutured to the 12th rib, or it may be sutured to the posterior abdominal wall muscle. In this way, the kidney becomes fixed. This is known as nephropexy. Now, after nephropexy, second important point regarding fibrous capsule. In cases of acute nephritic syndrome, acute nephritic syndrome in which there is increased amount of pressure on renal tubules, increased amount of edema, congestion, increased pressure on renal tubules, there will be suppression of urine. In those cases, suppression of urine. So in order to relieve that pressure, in order to relieve that suppression of urine, the surgeon performs one operation which is known as decapsulation. The capsule is removed from the external surface of the kidneys. Decapsulation of the operation is done in cases of acute nephritic syndrome in which there is excess of edema, congestion, pressure on the renal tubules, in which there is suppression of urine. In order to relieve all those symptoms, the surgeon may perform decapsulation of the kidney. So here, these are the two important points: nephropexy, decapsulation. Nephropexy, decapsulation regarding fibrous capsule. So we have discussed fibrous capsule entirely in detail. Now we move to renal fascia. Yes, one, this is left, but this perinephric layer will come in the diagram itself. Perinephric layer is a very thin layer. Perinephric layer of fat is a very thin layer of fat which is present between the two layers. Which two layers? We know that. fibrous capsule inside and outside mineral wall. So here, if we draw on this side, just half structure I will draw. Now this will be a diagram of lumbar vertebra, and here this we show this as the transverse process. Now after showing this, we will show the attachments of lumbar fascia, or it is called thoracolumbar fascia. Before that, we show the muscles which are attached, and the muscles which are attached will be, for example, here we will show there will be presence of psoas major muscle. There will be presence of psoas major muscle, and then we will show there will be the fascia covering the psoas major muscle. Then we will show quadratus lumborum muscle. So here we are going to show this as the quadratus lumborum muscle. Remember, this is a transverse section across thoracolumbar vertebra, across any of the thoracolumbar vertebra or lumbar vertebra. Psoas major, quadratus lumborum. This is psoas fascia. So here I will just mention this as psoas major. This is quadratus lumborum. This is psoas fascia. And then now we show anterior layer of lumbar fascia. This is the anterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia or lumbar fascia. Then over here, I hope this is visible. So here, middle layer of thoracolumbar fascia in this direction. Then after showing middle layer of thoracolumbar fascia, just posterior to the transverse process and the spinous. Here there will be presence of spinous process. So here in this area we are going to draw erector spinae muscle. So here we are showing this muscle as erector spinae. And covering the erector spinae will be posterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia. So that is what we are showing. This will be the posterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia. This is the posterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia. Now, at this point, where the anterior layer and middle layer of thoracolumbar fascia, where they are meeting, at that point we show two muscles, that is internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscle. So just in a sectional view, this is the internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscle, and another external oblique we show in this way. So these two muscles are the internal oblique, this muscle, and transversus abdominis, internal oblique and transversus abdominis, and this muscle will be external oblique muscle. So here, this is the psoas fascia. This is the anterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia or lumbar fascia, and this is the middle layer of thoracolumbar fascia, and here this is the posterior layer of the lumbar fascia, thoracolumbar fascia, and this is erector spinae. Now we draw the kidneys. We shall draw the kidneys here. So here we represent with violet color. We shall represent the cross section of the kidney. So therefore, this is the cross section of the kidney. Now, fibrous capsule. Remember, if I show with white color, this itself is the fibrous capsule. Here I am drawing the fibrous capsule covering the kidney, cross section of the kidney, transverse section of kidney. We have shown the fibrous capsule. This is the fibrous capsule. Now we show renal fascia, fascia of Gerota. Basically, definition of the renal fascia, fascia of Gerota. The fascia of Gerota or the renal fascia is condensation of extraperitoneal connective tissue surrounding the kidney. It is a condensation of extraperitoneal connective tissue surrounding the kidney. This is the definition. Please note down. Condensation of extraperitoneal connective tissue surrounding the kidney. Now, the entire renal fascia is divided into two layers, anterior layer, posterior layer, anterior layer, posterior layer. The name of anterior layer, here we are going to draw, now with the help of yellow color, I am going to draw, this is the anterior layer, and here this is the posterior layer. The name of the anterior layer of renal fascia is called fascia of Todd, T-O-D-L-T. L is silent. So fascia of Todd. Many times this is asked in one more question answer or in MCQ. Please note down. Anterior layer of renal fascia is called fascia of Todd. So here I will just mention this as fascia of Todd, anterior layer of renal fascia. Fascia of posterior layer or the posterior layer of renal fascia, this will be known as the fascia of Zuckerkand. Z-U-C-K, Zuckerkand. So this also name you need to memorize because it is asked so many times in MCQs or one more question answer. Posterior layer of renal fascia is known as fascia of Zuckerkand. So this is known as the fascia of Zuckerkand or posterior layer of renal fascia. So definition of renal fascia, it is a condensation of extraperitoneal connective tissue surrounding the kidneys. Division of renal fascia, it divides into anterior layer, posterior layer. Anterior layer is called fascia of Todd, posterior layer is called fascia of Zuckerkand. Now, transport disposition, that is why we have drawn this direction, this diagram. Laterally, the anterior and posterior layers will merge with each other and will join or will continue laterally as fascia transversalis. So laterally, now here I am going to show, laterally both the layers will form, merge and will form in this direction fascia transversalis. So therefore here we are going to mention this as fascia transversalis. So laterally you show they are going in this direction, deep, just deep to transversus abdominis muscle, and they will continue here as fascia transversalis. So laterally both the layers, anterior layer of renal fascia, posterior layer of renal fascia will merge and form fascia transversalis. They will continue as fascia transversalis. Laterally they will continue as fascia transversalis. Medially, medially the anterior layer of renal fascia, the posterior layer of renal fascia. Now anterior layer of renal fascia will cover the anterior surface of the kidney where my hand is there. Anterior layer of renal fascia, fascia of Todd, is covering the anterior surface of the renal, that is the anterior surface of the kidneys, and then it will continue opposite direction. It will continue towards the opposite side of the midline. It will cover here two important structures, and those two important structures, if we draw, supposing this is of right side, here we are going to show the inferior vena cava with its renal vein, and also we are going to show here, this is the abdominal aorta with its renal artery. So therefore, the anterior layer of renal fascia will cover the vena cava, inferior vena cava and abdominal aorta from the front, and then it will cross the midline towards the opposite side. It will be continuous with the anterior layer of renal fascia towards the opposite side. Please note down, this is very important. So anterior layer of renal fascia, after covering anterior surface of the kidney, will cover the anterior surface of inferior vena cava and abdominal aorta and will continue on the opposite side as anterior layer of renal fascia of the opposite kidney. Clear? Now posterior layer, the posterior layer of renal fascia, now see this, how important it is, how interesting, this posterior layer of renal fascia will straight away merge with the psoas fascia. What is psoas fascia? Fascia covering psoas major muscle. This is the fascia covering psoas major muscle. So it will merge with the psoas fascia, and here it merges with the psoas fascia. Posterior layer of renal fascia, that is fascia of Zuckerkand, will merge with the psoas fascia, and therefore it will be through psoas fascia, it will be attached to the sides of the bodies of the lumbar vertebrae. Then one important partition, the anterior and posterior layers of renal fascia, the anterior layer fascia of Todd, posterior layer fascia of Zuckerkand, the anterior and posterior layers will be joined together by a septum. So we need to show a septum. So here we show a septum. So this is how the septum is present, joining the anterior layer with the posterior layer of renal fascia. So together, this septum is joining the anterior and posterior layer of the renal fascia across the hilum. See where the septum is passing. The septum joining anterior layer and posterior layer is passing across the hilum. And in this way, now what we show is the second layer. This way the second layer of perinephric fat is isolated. So where is the second layer of perinephric fat? The second layer of perinephric fat, if I show, let me show with the blue color. This is the second layer of perinephric fat. Here I'm going to show, this is the perinephric fat. So this is the second layer, which is present as perinephric fat. Blue color, entire blue color is perinephric fat. So therefore here, that is the second layer, and here I'm going to name this as perinephric fat, the second layer. So because of this anterior layer of renal fascia, posterior layer of renal fascia, and the septum connecting them across the hilum, the perinephric fat is isolated. So it remains as a separate layer. The perinephric fat remains as a separate layer. That is layer number two. So we have finished the transverse disposition. The transverse disposition of renal fascia, that is fascia of Gerota. Transversely, laterally it is continuous as fascia transversalis. Medially, we know anterior layer is continuous in this direction. Posterior layer, as I have told you, merges with the psoas fascia. And across the hilum, there will be a septum which will join anterior layer and posterior layer. This is the septum across the hilum. So here, transverse disposition renal fascia, we have understood, very simple. Now, we will understand the longitudinal disposition of the renal fascia. What is the longitudinal disposition of the renal fascia? Superiorly and inferiorly. That is very important. So superiorly and inferiorly, if we want to understand, let me just rub this, create some space over here. And then, supposing sagittal section of the kidney. So in the sagittal section here, we show, let me show, this is the sagittal section of the kidney. And here, let me show, this is the sagittal section of the suprarenal gland covering the kidney. Now, sagittal section only. Renal fascia, how it is disposed longitudinally? Superiorly, the renal fascia will first cover the entire kidney. So superiorly, the renal fascia, this is the anterior layer of renal fascia, this is the posterior layer of renal fascia, and both the fascia will join and enclose the kidney. Then after enclosing superiorly, here the renal fascia, it will again split. So resplitting, again it will split superiorly. After enclosing the kidney, it will again split superiorly to enclose suprarenal gland, which is situated above the kidney. So after resplitting, it will again enclose suprarenal gland in a separate compartment. Then after covering the suprarenal gland, the renal fascia superiorly, it will fuse. Once again, it will fuse and will be continuous with inferior fascia of diaphragm. So here, there will be presence of diaphragm. So it will be continuous with the inferior fascia of the diaphragm, and that portion of renal fascia where it is continuous with inferior fascia of the diaphragm, that portion will be known as suspensory ligament of suprarenal gland. Note down. So this portion here will be known as suspensory ligament of suprarenal gland. This will be known as suspensory ligament of suprarenal gland. And this is, of course, the diaphragm. And here, below the diaphragm, this will be the thoracolumbar fascia, posteriorly. So this is the posterior side of the kidney and suprarenal gland. This will be the anterior side. So now we are clear in longitudinal disposition regarding one point. And what is that point? Superiorly. Superiorly, the renal fascia, both the layers, supposing this is anterior, so this is the anterior layer of renal fascia, which is known as fascia of Todd. Posterior layer of renal fascia, which is known as fascia of Zuckerkin. So both anterior posterior layers will enclose over the superior surface of kidney. Then again they will resplit and enclose suprarenal gland in a separate compartment. After enclosing suprarenal gland, they will again fuse and will cover the suprarenal gland, and they will be attached to inferior fascia of the diaphragm, where it will be known as suspensory ligament of suprarenal gland. So this portion will become suspensory ligament of suprarenal gland. Now what about lower, inferiorly? How will the renal fascia or what will they form inferiorly? Inferiorly, the renal fascia, remember, the renal fascia will continue. Supposing here, if I show the ureter in this direction, if I show the ureter, remember, this is the sagittal section only. I'm showing the ureter. Now, inferiorly, the renal fascia will line the ureter and will pass downwards. Here, it is lining the ureter, it will pass downwards. And will merge with extra peritoneal connective tissue of iliac fossa. So, inferiorly, the renal fascia will surround the ureter, will pass downwards, and will merge with extra peritoneal connective tissue of the iliac fossa. That is inferiorly. So, here I can just write down as the, it will merge with extra peritoneal connective tissue of iliac fossa. So, inferiorly, this is the disposition of renal fascia. Once again, the renal fascia, what we have finished is transverse disposition. What will happen to renal fascia laterally? What will happen to renal fascia medially? Then we have finished renal fascia, what will happen to renal fascia superiorly? And then what will happen to renal fascia inferiorly? That is what we have finished. Now, we come back to fibrous capsule. This is the important point which is left, fibrous capsule. Now, coming back. So therefore now, fibrous capsule here, this is the cross section of the kidney here, sagittal section, kidney, the hilum, the renal pelvis and the ureter. This is the basic structure of renal pelvis, how the renal pelvis will be then directed downwards to ureter. The renal pelvis will be divided into several of the major calyces here. These are the major calyces, and then each of the major calyces, minor calyces. And the spaces between the minor calyces is renal sinus. These are the spaces of renal sinus. So the fibrous capsule, as I had explained to you previously, it is a condensation of the fibrous stroma of the kidney. It will enclose the entire kidney. Will line, number one, the fibrous capsule will line the renal sinuses, number one. It will line all the renal sinuses. Number two, it will send a sheath covering the minor calyces and major calyces. So it will cover the minor and major calyces also. The fibrous capsule will cover the minor and major calyces in the form of a sheath, and then it will cover the renal pelvis. So four different structures it will cover, the fibrous capsule. Number one, it will line the renal sinus. Number two, it will send a sheath covering the minor calyces. Number three, it will send another sheath covering major calyces. And number four, it will cover the renal pelvis also. So these are the four important points where the fibrous capsule will cover. So with this, we end our lecture of gross anatomy segment 1, in which we have discussed till the level of coverings of the kidney. Fibrous capsule, perinephric fat, then the renal fascia and paranephric fat. What is paranephric fat? Paranephric fat is a layer of fat which is present outside the renal fascia. That means in between renal fascia and thoracolumbar fascia. Paranephric fat is present, just a thin layer of fat on the posterior surface of the kidney between thoracolumbar fascia and renal fascia. That is paranephric fat. So here we have finished the coverings. Thank you very much.